Yogena chittasya padena vacham malam sharirasya cha vaidyakena yopakarottam pravaram muninam padanjalim pranjali ranatosmi stuve padanjalim vyasam shankaram cha munitrayam kartrasutrasya bhashyasya kramad vivaranasya cha. So we were discussing this this sutra, which defines samadhi. There is tadeva arthamatra nirbhasam surupa shunyam iva samadhi. So as I said earlier, these three stages together are called samyama, dharana, dhyana, samadhi, and they are also considered to be more subtle and internal practices. So we must keep in mind the background. We are discussing Ashtanga Yoga, the eightfold discipline in Patanjali system: Yama, Niyama, Asana, Pranayama, Pratyahara, Dharana, Dhyana and Samadhi. So in these eight disciplines, there are three stages: the moral, the physical and the spiritual. First, we discussed Yama and Niyama, the moral. Ahimsa, Satya, Asteya, Brahmacharya, Aparigraha, these are Yamas, which are fundamental, universal. And then Shauja, Santosha, Tapas, Swadhyaya, Isvana, Panidhana, Niyamas. So first, the fundamental five disciplines, which are internal, more subtle and more crucial, that is non-violence, truthfulness, non-stealing, purity, chastity and of course non-possessiveness. So any spiritual seeker who wants to practice any kind of spiritual discipline should first focus on these five disciplines. And then the other five disciplines, which are dependent upon the first five ones: Shauja, Santosha, Tapas, Swadhyaya, Isvana, Panidhana, purity, internal and external, then contentment, then concentration, intense effort, then reading of scriptures, chanting of mantras, trying to raise our consciousness, mental awareness level, and of course a feeling, a sense of surrendering to God. Now, you will find in the later sutras that Patanjali considers that this dharana, dhyana and samadhi, the last three stages, as a single stage. So Trayamekatra Samyama means it is called Samyama, ending with Samadhi. Dharana is concentration. Any kind of meditation practices, you find the word Dharana is translated frequently as concentration. But we must remember that, as I mentioned many times earlier, Dharana actually implies any kind of meditative exercise. In fact, as I said earlier, many of the methods that we employ trying to focus our mind on certain things cannot really be called dhyanam in the true sense of the technical term dhyana. But rather, they are only different kinds of concentrations. Now, in what way are they related to the first fundamental disciplines? Before we take up samadhi, this should be kept in mind. The commentators do not give a very clear picture of what happens to a person who practices concentration without being established in the moral ethical disciplines mentioned in the Yama and Niyamas. But successive generations of teachers have made it very clear. The point is, Any person who tries to practice dharana, that is the first of the samyama stage. Anyone who practices dharana means focusing mind on in a particular object for a long time or a fixed time, amount of time. If a person does this without fully being established in moral disciplines, what happens is natural tendencies will get intensified. Tendencies which are not purified or disciplined through morality, through Yama Niyama, may get sharpened and can create a problem. Maybe I cannot explain this better than giving an illustration from one of our mythological books. You know, the story comes in many of our mythological books, Puranas, Bhagavad and others. The story is about Bhasmasura. And Bhasma means, you know, Vibhuti. Vibhuti here, not Vibhuti mentioned in Yoga Sutra title. Vibhuti means ashes. Now, Asura is a demon. A person is called Asura, he's a demon, an evil person. So here is the story of an evil man. His name was, what name he had, we do not know, but he got this peculiar name, you will understand as the story unfolds. He meditated for a long time. Intense meditation. I mean, you took bath 3 times, 4 times a day, did not sleep much. He got some mantras from some source, and he fasted maybe with great physical effort, with great mental concentration, intensity, he meditated on God. God here means, let's say, one of the trinities in Hindu popular Hindus. It's called Shiva. That is the name. So he meditated for a long time, for several years. So stories given to illustrate this important point, the importance of Yama and Niyama in any kind of meditative practice. So as he said, you know, he meditated for many years. Finally, Shiva knew the fellow is somewhat tricky. His intentions are not good, to put it modern language, he was up to no good. He knew that. But then he was chanting his name, won't eat anything, had given up all his obligations, everything. He was doing this intensely for several years. What will you do? Suppose a man of an undesirable character sits in front of your home and fast and say that he won't eat anything, he won't move away from there unless you appear before him. Still, out of compassion, you may open the door and appear before him. At least, because after all, he was sitting in front of your home. So you feel a moral obligation, like the Shiva felt a moral obligation to appear before him. And Shiva, out of compassion, though he knew this man, what sort of person he was, and he appeared before him. So this Bhasmasura was very happy. And now if after a long concentration and spiritual practices, tapasya, if God appears, the demon has a right to ask for some boon. So Shiva, as usual, well, what's the matter? What do you want? You ask for some boon. Said, I want one boon. What is that? Anyone whom I touch on his forehead should die. That is the boon that this fellow wanted. So Shiva was, though he was great, he was somewhat, he didn't expect the fellow will turn against him after all. So Shiva gave the boon readily. And Bhasmasura wanted to test this boon on Shiva's head himself. So Bhasmasura turned against Shiva and tried to touch his head. Shiva started running away all over. Shiva went everywhere. He was running all over the place to escape from this man's touch, because if Bhasmasura who had got this boon touches on his forehead, he will die. And he was chasing Shiva to touch on his forehead. And he went to different places. Then finally he went to Vishnu. Vishnu was great, but he could see through this man's trick. So Vishnu was sitting there, the Shiva, maybe must have entered Vishnu's palace, so Shiva, Vishnu was standing. And Bhasmasura came, mind you, he got his boon from Shiva and he wanted to test that boon on Shiva's head, forehead. So Vishnu, see, what's the matter? Oh, I want to test my new power on Shiva's head. Then said, oh, you are such a fool. Who would believe that Shiva's boon, you know? It has no value. See, you should be an absolute fool to trust, to believe that Shiva's boon will work. Otherwise, you test on your own head, I will see. And Bhasmasura put his hand on his own head and he was burned to ashes. So Bhasma means ash. So he got this name, Bhasmasura. Now, the story is not the point. The point is, this man was of a violent nature with undesirable emotions, full of trickishness. So what happened, you know, when he got this new power, he did not know how to make use of these powers. So Vibhutipada will deal with this, the chapter we are dealing with, will deal with so many supernatural powers that one may gain if he or she practices different yogic exercises. So the important point is, any effort to meditate or focus our mind on an object will intensify the natural tendencies and faculties of the mind to a higher level. Now, what about the supernatural powers? You can scientifically explain this. In fact, your Patanjali is very rational, very scientific. Just as you do physical exercise according to a particular system or discipline, you develop enormous physical faculties, which if you do not practice those disciplines, you won't be able to get. So also the mental level. Also, if we do inner mental exercise, then mind also develops different faculties and special capacities, which are called vibhuti in this context. So, but before we undertake any of the serious practices, especially beginning with dharana, dhyana and samadhi, we must get fully established in the yamas and niyamas, because yamas and niyamas will educate us how to make proper use of these faculties that we naturally develop when we practice meditation. So that's the importance of meditation. Now, in actual life, how do we do that? That's what we are going to deal with. The first step is to raise the level of our mental consciousness. Consciousness is a word frequently used here. For sometimes the consciousness is the English translation of the word prajna that we are going to discuss in the subsequent sutras. That's not what we are talking about right now. Here, what I mean is the level of our mental awareness, where we stand mentally, where we stand, what our emotions, thought currents are. That's what we are discussing. The first step in practicing any kind of meditative exercises is to raise the level of our mental consciousness or mental awareness, which also involves indirectly feeding our mind with good thoughts, good emotions, good attitudes, good impulses, so that when we try to sit somewhere and practice dharana or meditation, undesirable tendencies and impressions will not emerge in the mind. And also, the higher faculties of the mind, that gradually we acquire as we practice yoga will not become a liability to us and to others, as it happened in the case of Bhasmasura. So that's the central point. So how do we raise the level of mental awareness before we take the first step in Samyama? So we must remember, Dharana, Dhyana and Samadhi together are called Samyama. Trayam ekatra Samyama, this is Patanjali's definition. So first we must raise mind's awareness level or concentration. How do we do this? Feed the mind with good food, where the mind goes automatically. If we sit somewhere without thinking, if we can watch our mind, in which direction the mind goes, then you can understand where our mind, mental awareness level is. First of all, we find a mixed bag of thought currents will emerge in the mind, good and bad. So when you practice this part B, sometimes called, you know, this witness meditation or witness sip or all that, you will be able to detach yourself from undesirable thought currents. But it will be only a temporary solution. It is much more important to keep the mind in a world of higher thoughts, higher ideas. For that, we must think of how the mind gets its food from external world. When we see an object with our eyes, both mind and the sense of vision, sense of sight are involved. When we hear a sound, mind and sense of hearing are involved. When we touch an object, then also the sense of touch and mind are involved. Like that, mind is always involved in any kind of sensory cognition perception. And every cognition and perception will bring to the mind some sensation, it's called vrittis, which may become vasanas and samskaras. We cannot consciously do something without some vrittis, samskaras, being created in our mind after that action is over. It's called a residual element after every act. Every act of perception or cognition, this residual element will be left. And this has a tendency to become memory, an impression, which may re-emerge in our mind the moment we try to practice dharana and the moment we try to practice meditation, dhyana. So if we can feed our mind with pleasant, desirable, healthy tendencies and impressions, then it will help us to concentrate. Thoughts of higher ideas, events and incidents from sages who have themselves practiced meditation, prayer, or have some mantras, sacred prayers, psalms, any of these things, association with which will help us to raise the level of mental awareness. Through this process, we are preparing ourselves to practice dharana. Once we are established in Yama and Niyama, then this becomes automatic. But you know, Yama and Niyama, when you read the list, it sounds like some 10 fundamental disciplines. But how do we actually practice them? For that, we have to think of the way the five senses drag the mind towards different objects and how the experiences involving the five senses of perception and mind create residual elements, vasanas and vrittis, which again become memories, which become images and impressions, which may re-emerge in our mind the moment we withdraw from any physical activity and sit somewhere and try to concentrate or contemplate. This happens. So our natural tendency of the mind should be to move towards higher thoughts and higher ideas. This is the real purpose of practicing Yama. In actual practice, what we must do, we are reading many things, read some good books. We are seeing many things, also try to see many wonderful things which may create healthy memories, healthy imageries in the mind. We are hearing many things, try to hear wonderful things, wonderful ideas, mantras, hymns, good songs, anything like that, holy statements, things like that. All this will raise the level of mental awareness. Mental awareness means where the mind actually functions. Then we are ready to practice dharana. But here we must remember, of course, you know, I mentioned this earlier, moral perfection through yama and niyama, physical perfection through asana, pranayama, etc. And my mind again gets more training through pratyahara, and then reaches the three last stages of development through samyama, that is dharana, dhyana, and samadhi. So the first fundamental discipline is yama and niyama. And this should be practiced through all these disciplines. According to traditional yoga teachers, the most effective practice for raising the mental awareness is reading, chanting, repeating holy words and prayer. Because prayer will have one effect. Prayer will have a soothing effect on the mental system. And that will help us much faster to reach the level of mental awareness necessary for practicing yama and niyama. So we must always relate this samyama with this first sutra mentioned in Ashtanga Yoga. That means yama, niyama, asana, pranayama, pratyahara, dharana, dhyana, samadhi, ashto angani. This is sutra, 29th sutra of this sadhana pada. Self-restraint, observances, posture, regulation of breath, withholding of the senses, fixing the mind, meditation, and perfect concentration are the eight limbs of yoga. So of these, yama and niyama are vital and fundamental. You will understand how fundamental it is when we discuss, of course we already discussed to some extent, the difference between ordinary concentration and concentration as understood in the yoga tradition. So, what is ordinary concentration? So, ordinary concentration is natural absorption in a work, in a book. There is effortlessness involved, and there is spontaneity is there, but that spontaneity is linked to our natural tendency to follow the path of the senses. Our senses drag the mind to certain areas, certain activities, and when we are engaged in that activity, we forget ourselves. That may develop certain faculties for an artist, for a scientist, for a creative artist or a musician to attain a higher level of their artistic aesthetic faculties, but it doesn't make you a yogi. If you want an example, I don't mean any offense, but you find people with great creative faculties who achieved great things in music, art, and many things, you know. After the performance, they are not able to control their mind. Often they want to run away from their mind. And there are so many avenues for people to escape in the world of realities. Suddenly the mind goes down. So a great musician, who may be a genius in music or in any kind of creative art, may get completely absorbed in the performance of that artistic, the particular art, have tremendous natural interest in it. But the problem is, before or after the performance of that art, that person will have no control over his mind. There is a tendency among many of them, going to the other extreme. The mind suddenly comes down with a jerk and hits the bottom. So they want to forget from the world of realities, and there are so many avenues. Alcoholism may be one of them, but there are many. But a yogi doesn't need this. A yogi will have the same higher creative faculty in whatever areas he may specialize, but he is able to keep his mind at a higher level. So in the concentration of a yogi, there is awareness, self-control, self-mastery. In the concentration of an ordinary person, this self-mastery is absent. So these are some of the differences that you find in the practice of concentration in the context of a yogi and also in the context of ordinary life situations. The difference is, a yogi reaches this level of concentration, dharana, dhyana, through the practice of yama and niyama, but a creative artist may reach a very high level of self-identification with his chosen field or profession, but he has not gone through this path of yama and niyama. So yama and niyama prepares the mind to reach a very high level, but there is an element of freedom, spiritual freedom, self-mastery, and a natural effortless faculty to remain in a state of perpetual awareness in the context of a yogi. That's the main difference. Now we will come to the next sutra that we already discussed. So the next sutra is, of course, Trayamekatra Samyamaha. That is fourth sutra in the Vibhuti Pada. So dharana, dhyana, and samadhi, these three together constitute samyama, the technical name. So samyama is the last three stages of it. Samadhi is the last. So very often the commentators, from their books we understand the subtle distinctions between dhyana and samadhi. So we have to keep in mind, dhyana is a stage that we reach after going through dharana. And before we practice dharana, we must be fully established in yama, niyama. In such a situation, what happens? What's the difference between dhyana and samadhi? So in dhyana, of course, there is a self-direction, but there is an effort. Effort means, when you reach that higher level of meditation where the mind gets completely focused on an object, complete concentration, there is self-direction, is awareness is there because you practiced yama niyama. It is not that when TV opens, football game is going on, you naturally go and sit there, get completely absorbed in it. No. So a yogi will be able to, even if you are interested in these things, can switch it off, go there and meditate if he wants. So there is self-effort involved. That's the main. There is effort involved. When you practice dharana also, after practicing yama and niyama, you will be able to tell yourself, well, this is what I want. So you can switch your mind off to certain things. As I know, switching off the TV. You may be interested in it, but you'll be able to tell, you must have had a past in which you are a professional player. But if you become a yogi by practice of yama and niyama, you will be able to mentally switch it off and sit there and meditate. So there is self-direction and there is an effort. But in samadhi, you know, even if it is going there in front of you, your mind will be naturally flowing towards it. So every effort involves some degree of imperfection. So dhyana is a penultimate state just before samadhi. Here the question arises, what about dharana? Even when we try to focus our mind on certain things, frictions, irritation, all these tendencies, these are very common. If you read the letters that frequently will receive you, or if you read the teachings of some of the great direct disciples of Sri Ramakrishna's direct disciples, Swami Tattwamayananda's letters, still if you read, or letters of other direct disciples, how they had to answer to the questions raised in the letters from their disciples or devotees, what all problems they had to encounter during meditation. So if you read them, you'll understand that there is one common problem. One is, after practicing some prayer, some meditation, or even reading or listening to some lectures, a kind of boredom, irritation, irritable tendencies, irritability, boredom. Oh, there is not much sense in it. Such sides, there is a stumbling block. Actually, this is a test. It is natural for every sincere seeker. A large percentage of spiritual seekers will be crushed by this experience. A kind of irritability at the subjective level, boredom, and also a skeptical mentality, doubtfulness, all these will end. If you are total atheist, we never made any effort to understand any spiritual idea, this problem may not come. But when we make some effort in this direction, then at one stage, this kind of tendencies will come. It's all because we have not gone through the basic discipline of yama and niyama. The yama and niyama, as you understand, you know, in the Patanjali system, in a different way it is put in Vedantic tradition. In Vedantic tradition, it is put in a different context using a different vocabulary. It is called sadhana chatushtaya. First, we must try to understand what is real and what is unreal. Then we must have a strong determination to follow the real and leave behind the unreal. But it requires a much higher effort than necessary for practicing Patanjali system. It requires a higher willpower. So, what is real in this world? Make a decision. What do I want? Do I want to practice spiritual sadhanas? Do I want to do spiritual practices? Or do I just follow the normal path of life? And then, why do I want to do spiritual practices? Is it real? What about other things? So, other things may be real, but this is the real, the absolute reality, the capital R, real. Once we come to this decision, then we must have a strong will to renounce the relative, unreal, empirical, worldly things, mentally at least, and then follow the path of the real. And of course, we must have a strong desire for spiritual evolution, for evolving in spiritual life, which we call, you know, desire for liberation, technically speaking, Mumukshutvam. But at least a strong desire to be different from ordinary human beings who are born, who make money, live and die and reborn like this. If we can have a higher spiritual goal in life, that will help us to take a strong decision and to follow the path of higher life. So this effort, an effort to acquire this higher sublime destination, I mean goal, to reach this higher goal in spiritual life, spiritual illumination, will automatically and naturally give us yamas and niyamas. So a person who is interested in his spiritual destiny, in achieving a higher level of spiritual life, will naturally be practicing, will be naturally inclined to practice ahimsa, satya, asteya, all these yamas and niyamas. So these are the two different approaches. The approach in Vedanta is sadhana chatushtaya. Technically in Sanskrit is called nitya anitya vastu viveka ihamutra phalabhoga viraga samadhi sarka sambhati mumukshutvam. In English I already explained. First of all, we must have an idea of what is the real thing that we must achieve in life and what are other things, the rest of it. And once we have get a conviction, we must leave the other things behind and follow this path. And then along with that, naturally we will be able to renounce the lower things in life. Renunciation doesn't mean going away, running away, etc. In our mind we can prioritize, you know, we can change the system of priority in our life. There are wonderful things happening. An average householders, we have to live in this world, we have to work, make money, look after many things around. But along with that, one should also be able to give place to some higher spiritual aspiration. That is the beginning of spiritual life. And once we focus on this, then yamas and niyamas will automatically follow. So when we use the English translation of Viveka Chudamani's verse, you know, we should not be frightened. In modern context, in the context of householders or people living in society, it has got a different message. But the central message is this: we must change the priority of, the order of priority of things in our life. So we must give place to some higher spiritual ideal. And that will automatically keep the mind linked to it. And this connection of the mind to this higher spiritual ideal will automatically help us to practice ahimsa, satya, asteya, yamas and niyamas. That is why Patanjali says, Isha pranidhanadva. I mean, if we can resign ourselves to God's will, or if we can pray sincerely, that will take care of many of the imperfections in acquiring yamas and niyamas. That's the idea behind. Then there is another important discipline is mentioned here. Patanjali also discusses the subject of dharana, dhyana and samadhi. So dharana is the first step in the samyama level, taking us all the way to samadhi. So dharana literally means a conceptual awareness, means where there are many concepts, many ideas in our mind, but we take a decision to focus on some higher ideal and practice dharana. So I mentioned earlier on one occasion, most of the meditative practices that we do with mindfulness, or many of these meditation practices, or even in the Christian monastic meditation practices, can be classified in this category of dharana and not dhyana. Because in many of these meditation practices, The main focus is a statement from the holy book, holy work. Dharana also is also focusing our mind on a great ideal or a symbol. But in dhyana, which is higher, what happens? This conceptual awareness derived from a single conception. So this conceptual awareness is not one of the awareness experiences from different concepts, one out of many concepts. It is coming from a single concept, dhyana, where, you know, the word and knowledge and the meaning of that particular word remain mixed one. But in samadhi, only what you meditate upon alone remains. There is complete identification. Now, what is awareness? In other words, we can say, in what way is the dharana, focus, or concentration, or meditation, or focusing on a single idea, different from ordinary concentration? That's mentioned. Was mentioned earlier, in ordinary concentration, there is total identification. It is also spontaneous. There is also an element of effortlessness involved, but there is no freedom involved. There is no awareness involved. The child interested in watching football, he may get completely absorbed in it. When we read a poetry, we may completely forget everything. So there is complete concentration. The concentration aspect of dharana is there actually. In the ordinary concentration, which is rooted in interest, which may be rooted in desire also. A finance expert, a businessman, who loses himself completely in his business negotiations. Or an artist who draws a picture, or a musician who sings, completely absorbed. So, but then after this, he may have to drink also to come down to normal level. This also happens among many artists. It's a fact. What does it mean? There is no awareness involved in that. The awareness element is absent in ordinary concentration because it is rooted in natural interests. There is no freedom. There is no awareness. There is also an element of helplessness. A person who is so naturally involved in such activities, who may reach a very high level of perfection in that area, cannot bring himself from in it, even if he tries. So there is an element of helplessness and total absence of freedom. In dharana dhyana, the same level of concentration is achieved, but there is complete freedom and awareness because the yogi who reaches this level of dharana through the path of yama and niyama reaches the same level of concentration and identification called tadatmya in Sanskrit, with complete freedom and awareness. So he will be able to do everything, still come out of it anytime he wants. That is the difference between yogic concentration and ordinary concentration. In other words, we can say in yogic concentration there is called a sakshi aspect. Sakshi actually means witness. Now, witness is not indifferent. You cannot call him a witness. There are two aspects involved in the word sakshi as understood in Vedanta. Bodhrutvat audasinitvat sakshitvam. That is the definition. It's a very famous definition. Vedanta, you find all these ideas are very technically, clearly defined. Who is a sakshi? Sakshi is a person who is aware of what is happening in front of him, but he is not involved in it. Audasinya means he is not involved. He is a spectator, but he is fully aware of it. Now, awareness and the state of being a spectator without being involved in it are possible only when we reach the highest level of Samadhi. That's the main difference. To explain it further, I can give the example of a play going on in a stage. You are sitting in the gallery watching the play going on the stage. On the stage, there are actors. You cannot call them sakshi. They are not witnesses because they are involved in the act of playing the drama. But there is a wall, there is a pillar on the stage. It is not involved. But it cannot be witness because it has no awareness. The pillar is only pillar. The curtain, it is there, but it is not. There is no awareness in it. So, but a person sitting on the stage is watching this. He is not involved. And if he wants, he can be aware. He can closely watch what is going on. So, when we reach the level of dharana, dhyana and samadhi, gradually we reach the level of being a spectator in this drama of life with full awareness. And awareness implies total freedom, not the helplessness of a person who cannot get out of his hobby, which he knows very well to be destructive, to be ruinous to him. So the higher skills, so that's why we are dealing with the Vibhutipada, the higher skills and faculties which a person may develop through the practice of yoga should be used properly. And yogi develops the ability to use them in an appropriate manner, or not to use them at all. That is the greatness of a yogi or anyone who follows the path of yoga through the first few stages prescribed in the system, the Yama, Niyamasana, Pranayama, Pratyahara, etc. Now we will have interaction for some time and then continue. We must remember, you know, these things may not be easily taught in a yoga studio, because here yoga is taken as a comprehensive spiritual philosophy of life. So that's what Patanjali means by the word yoga. That's all should be understood.
Some of the Christian mystics like Meister Eckhart, yeah, and others speak of a contemplative practice which seems to be more akin to manana, that type of reflection involving like a theme,
yeah,
more than dharana. Could you explain a little bit what you mean by the Christian mystics emphasizing dharana?
Yeah, that's what I was discussing. You know, in monasteries during Middle Ages, they used to discuss and focus and concentrate on certain important statements from the Bible.
Yes.
And then, well, if a man of Mr. Eckhart's stature meditates on the meaning of a statement from the Bible, it can take him to the highest level of dhyana. But it depends upon the level of yama and niyama that the particular individual has gone through constant practice, through pious life, through meditation, one naturally develops these faculties. So it's not that you should first practice ahimsa, then satya. No, all of them come naturally to a spiritual seeker through prayer, for example. And Eckhart and many of the mystics of that age used to pray for a long time. So through prayers, all these faculties naturally become. And when they concentrate on the meaning of certain statements, they may go beyond the level of manana. So manana literally means focusing, concentrating on the meaning of the particular word. But going beyond that, beyond concentrating on the meaning of the word, they may identify themselves with the meaning of the word. In that case, you know, it reaches the level of dhyana. And the word itself vanishes, only the essence of what the word implies remains, then becomes samadhi. So the one who meditates, the act of meditation and what is meditated upon, the distinction completely vanishes and only what is meditated upon remains in its essence, not in gross form. Then it is a samadhi. So it depends upon the spiritual seeker. A spiritual seeker of Eckhart's stature may have reached samadhi, but you know, the technical term was not used in the Christian mystical tradition, but the experience that we mean by the word samadhi must have been experienced by great mystics in any tradition. So that's the implication. So thank you.
Swamiji, is the meaning of samadhi always analogous with like leaving the body, or can it be?
Yeah, yes. You know, that is when you reach samadhi. That's a word used in that context. No, in a way, there are different schools of reaching illumination in Vedantic tradition. One is videha mukti, means where you become liberated when you leave this body. So in that sense, sometimes it is used in that context. But here, what Patanjali means is something different. It means a very the supreme level of yoga consciousness, attainment of yoga consciousness, the highest level. That's what it means. Nothing to do with death or passing away. Many of these terms, you know, are used in language, in popular conversation, with different implications. When it becomes part of the popular language. Yes.
To go back to your earlier example with Bhasmasura, so we've seen that a lot in mythological stories,
yeah,
where you know asuras,
yeah,
go through meditation.
Yeah, Ravana, all this.
Ravana, yes.
All this. They were men of terrible concentration, strong will, and they ready to do whatever it takes them to reach the goal. But then the purpose was different. So maybe these stories have a implication, meaning. That's what Vyasa himself writes.
So then, I mean, would we say it's like poor judgment on...
Why go to the mythologies in the history of human civilization? You find many eminent men and women who reached a very high level of mental faculties, strong willpower, power of concentration. Look at a man like Genghis Khan, you see, Napoleon, power of strong willpower, power of concentration, all these faculties. So, but there we can see these faculties, they got these faculties because they may inborn abilities to focus on things and to get complete, to put all their mental energies on one focus. So that is a central common factor in all efforts of the mind. You know, scientists, for example. So great truth is revealed by nature. So these are examples, you know. For even history, you find many scourges of humanity. Hitler was a man of tremendous power of concentration, strong will, and go to the extent of, monomania. That's a different matter. But then you find many, even among the scourges of humanity, evil persons, got this Bhasmasura, like that. So it simply shows one important, message, that is, all great faculties should be built upon these fundamental moral disciplines. Then they become a blessing to us and to others. Otherwise, they become a liability to both. In the Patanjali system, it is especially important because it's an internal journey. It is not here in Ashtanga Yoga, it is an internal spiritual evolution and journey. So unless we first try to practice Yamas and Niyamas, and then, for example, if you practice pranayama with yamas and niyamas, it is very obvious, it can be physiologically proven that when you do pranayama with some complicated asanas, we generate energy, enthusiasm. Whatever natural tendency you have got will get hyperactivated because the nervous system gets completely overhauled and you become... It could lead to restlessness, it could lead to hyperactivity, bipolar problems, all this could happen. But if one had practiced yamas and niyamas, and swadhyaya especially, then these tendencies will not, these evil, undesirable problems will not emerge. Because by practicing yamas and niyamas, the doors to the undesirable channels will be closed. By the practice of ahimsa, non-violence, your tendency to become violent will be closed. So this extra energy generated by the practice of pranayama and asanas and full concentration, pratyahara, the energy will flow in the proper channel. If a person is greedy because he has not practiced asteya or abarigraha. If he is greedy, then if so much of energy is generated, it may make him more greedy and will be in trouble. So that's the reason. So through the practice of yamas and niyamas, the channels through which the energy may flow towards undesirable directions, unhealthy directions, will be closed. That's the idea. So we will have class next Friday. Thank you. Namaskar. Om Shanti 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 Harihi Om Tat Sat Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa.